Are you tired of spending time recreating the same effects over and over again in Resolve? This is what a lot of you have been asking for, so let's get into it. Here's everything you need to know to create your own effects in DaVinci Resolve. There's a bunch of different ways that you can create your own effect in Resolve, but if you want something that's really accessible, the best method is to create a macro or a .settings file. A macro is essentially your own node that you can bring into your composition whenever you need it. I've got this little Twitter handle animation going on here, and it's taken me some time to put this together, so I've saved it as a macro. Now, the great thing about a macro is that you can completely customize it to have whatever controls you want in the inspector section. It's sort of like creating your own little plugin within Fusion, which is really handy. So let's rewind and I'll show you how I actually made this. Side note here, if you're interested in getting your hands on this Twitter animation, I'm giving it away for free. There's a link in the comments for you to download it. So this is the full composition with all the nodes that are needed to recreate this effect. A couple of parts I want to call attention to first because it will be important later on. First of all, the main gradient color of this oval shape is being controlled by this background node here, which I've labeled as main fill. So as you can see, I've got a gradient set up here on this background node, and I've got these nice blue and purple colours going on. Now, the little neon shimmer that runs around the edge is actually being driven by this background node here, which I've called Neon Fill, which we can change the colour of using this node if we wanted to. To turn this into a macro, first I'll highlight the whole thing, everything here except the media out. Now, you never include the media out in the creation of a macro, and there's a pretty good reason for that, which I'll come back to later in the video. With the rest of our nodes highlighted, I'm going to right click one of the nodes and go to Macro, Create Macro. At this point, the macro editor box is going to pop up with a whole bunch of different options with checkboxes. And this seems overly complicated at this point, but these are just all the parameters and controls for all of the nodes that we just highlighted a moment ago. So first things first, let's give our macro a name. Then what we can do with these checkboxes is we can select the parameters that we want to include as options in the inspector window once the macro is saved. I'm going to just move this window over to the side a bit for now just to show you how this works. So if I click on our text2 node, which is driving this Twitter handle here, and then I scroll down to find text2 in our list, you'll see that all the parameters that are normally in a text node are here too. So I'm going to go into the text section and just enable style text, which is the text box. I'll also include the color as well. Just remember, if you are including a color picker, you do need to include all three RGB channels. So I'm going to tick all of these. For this animation, I really want to be able to change the background color later on, as well as the main color of the neon animation that's running around it. So I'm going to find my main fill and neon fill nodes that I showed you earlier and include the color parameters from those nodes too. I can also rename these parameters if I want to, just to make it clearer what they are in the macro. Now, we don't have to worry too much about what we want to include at this stage because we can always come back and change these later if we need to. Anything that you've selected will be highlighted as red for now. So once you're happy with all the parameters you've included, you can come up to click on the three dots here. And here we're going to have a bunch of options for saving our macro. Open lets us open a different macro if we want to edit it later. Save and save as are fairly self-explanatory, but one you might want to be aware of is this save as a group option. Save as a group will let you keep the editability of your nodes in the macro. So rather than saving it all as one node, it will save it as a group node, where we can open it up and edit or move the inner workings of the macro as we please. Which, depending on what you're building, might be something you want to do if you want that flexibility later on. But for this one though, I just want to save it as one node. So I'm going to go ahead and hit save as. This is going to pop up with your macros folder, which is buried away in an application folder for DaVinci Resolve, but it's the right place to save our macro to. So go ahead and save this as a .settings file in that folder. Now once you've done that, you can go ahead and close that window because we can now bring this macro into our composition at any time. So I'm just going to switch to an empty composition here first. Now from up in the effects window, I can search for my macro and bring it into our composition as one single node and connect it up. Now with it selected, you'll see that we've got all the parameters that we had selected in the macro editor here in the inspector window. So I can change the value of these really easily from here. If you want to come back and change the parameters that you have in the inspector window, Then you come down and right click in the node window and go to edit macro. Then you can select your macro and it will bring the editor window back up again, where you can make the changes you want to make. As long as you save it from that three dot menu, when you're finished again, it will update it. So this is where Fusion's at its most powerful, creating reusable effects like this. But we do have to come into the Fusion tab to create it. So what if we wanted to add something like this to our effects tab in the edit page? Now thankfully, all the effects in the edit page use the exact same macro function. There's only a couple of extra steps that we need to take. Something you'll notice in the edit page is that your effects are actually filtered down into different types. Depending on what you've created, you can actually add your macro to one of these categories by saving your .settings file in the right folder path. To show you what I mean, I'm going to use this little Twitter animation again. I've gone ahead and created a .settings file for this, but rather than saving it to the default macros folder that we saw earlier, instead I've gone ahead and saved that on my desktop. From within the Fusion page, we want to come into the effects panel and scroll down to templates. In this dropdown, you'll see an option for edit, and then within edit, you'll find the same categories from our edit page with all the same effects that we have on the edit page. Now for the purposes of this effect, I want to save this as a generator. So I'm going to select generator. I'll then click on the three dots up here and select show folder, which will pop up with the exact location that we want to save our macro to. So that's a really quick hack that you can use to find the right folder path if you're ever unsure where to save your macro. I'll then drag my .settings file into this folder. And if we come back into results edit page, we'll see that it's now added this Twitter macro to this section. If you can't see it in there yet, you might have to do a quick restart or resolve. But if you followed those steps, you should see it on the edit page and you should be able to drag it into your timeline when you please. All the controls that we set up in Fusion will now be in the inspector window on the edit page as well, which is really handy. It means you can update things without having to jump back into the Fusion page, which is really cool. Okay, so right now you might be thinking, does it really matter which of these categories that I save my macro to? And the answer is yes, it does. It matters a lot. Each of these categories gets treated differently in the edit page depending on what one you're using. This part might seem kind of self-explanatory, but stay with me here because it's key to understanding how macros work. Do you remember earlier in the video when I said, now you never include the media out in the creation of a macro? And there's a pretty good reason for that. Well, in some cases you don't want to include a media in either. Let's say, for example, you're making something like a filter effect, where you have a clip of video footage being fed into a bunch of other nodes, and you want to be able to replicate this as an effect for the edit page. You should only copy the nodes in the middle that are actually affecting the footage, not the footage itself. Whenever we have a piece of video footage on our timeline, as far as Fusion's concerned, this is a media in node being connected directly to a media out. So when we drag an effect onto a clip from the effect category, Fusion automatically slots our macro in the chain in between the media in and the media out. On the other hand, if you're dragging in a title or a generator, for example, then Fusion assumes you're generating an image and just directly connects this up to a media out, which is why these automatically generate a clip whenever they're dragged onto the timeline, as opposed to effects which are applied to the clip. So when you come round to creating your first effect for the edit page, think carefully about where you want it to go, because it's really easy to drop it in the wrong folder and then it doesn't really function the way you want it to. I've made that mistake myself. Now speaking of effects in the edit page, something you may have also noticed about the default title effects you get in Resolve is that they automatically retime themselves to match exactly how long the clip is, which if you're doing something like a lower third animation or a title, is really handy. This is something you could set up for your own animations too. To do this, we use a process called Anim curves. Anim curves will let you animate any parameter you want in Fusion, just like a keyframe does. But unlike keyframes, Anim curves work as a percentage of your overall composition length, which means that when you change the clip length in the edit page, the animation automatically retimes itself. There's a few different scenarios where you might want to set up an Anim curve, but by far the simplest example is a pie chart timer like this. Now I'm not going to show you how I set this up, but I have set it up as a macro just like I showed you earlier. I've left a link in the comments if you want to download that for free. In this macro, I've set up a single control for the percentage of the pie chart. And as you can see here, this will fill the pie chart when I move the slider here. Pretty simple. Let's say I wanted this to start at 0 at the start of our composition and then automatically fill to 1 over the course of my entire clip length. Now instead of keyframing this across a predefined number of frames, I'm going to right click the percentage parameter and go to modify width and select Anim Curves. And just to remind you, this will work on any parameter in Fusion. Now, it's actually made our pie chart disappear just now, but that's totally normal. If I jump over to the Modifiers tab, you'll see that this Anim Curves modifier has been added. So we can see a bunch of controls here. So for the purposes of this, I'm going to set the source to duration because we want this parameter to change over the duration of our composition. And then we're going to leave the rest of this section as it is for now, but we will come back to this. If we play back our composition, you'll see that it's animating exactly the way we want it by itself, which is amazing. So it starts at the first frame with nothing and then fills over the course of the composition length. I can go back to the Tools tab here to see this in action too. This is pretty easy to set up, but what exactly is happening here? Well, it's because of the scale, offset, time scale, and time offset controls, which won't mean anything to you just now, but here's exactly what these parameters are doing. Scale is essentially how much you want this parameter to change. So in this case, we want the percentage slider to end on 1. But if we said 0.5, for example, it would only fill up half of our pie chart over the duration of the composition, because that percentage parameter is only being asked to scale by 0.5. Offset, essentially, is what number do you want your parameter to start on? In this case, we want it to start on 0, but if I was to put in 0.25, you'll see the effect that has on the pie chart. It now starts a quarter of the way full. Time scale is essentially how fast do you want this animation to go. You could kind of think of this as like a speed modifier, so 1 would be 1 times the speed, 2 would be 2 times the speed, and it would finish halfway through the composition, and then 4 would be 4 times the speed, and so on and so on. And then the last part is time offset, which just lets you shift at what point in time you want the animation to start. So positive values are going to add a small delay, but negative values will mean that your animation starts later in the composition. If you're totally lost at this stage, then please don't worry, I was totally lost learning this stuff as well. The main thing to do is just go in and play about with those parameters and see how it affects your animation. Because once you master those 4 controls, you can basically recreate any kind of reusable animation that you want. And as you can see from the edit page, this pie chart timer is automatically retiming itself to suit the length of our clip, regardless of its size, which is much more useful than having to go in and change keyframes every time you want to use this. You could just stretch that clip out and then you know that that timer is going to lapse around that entire time scale. Now you could actually use Anim Curves to create in and out animations that automatically retime themselves, just like this text animation here. And this is the method that you'll most commonly find across YouTube for creating this kind of reusable in and out animation, but I'm not a fan of it. It's kind of messy because stretching the clip also stretches the timing of the animation. So the longer it is, the slower it animates, which you probably don't want. Most of the time, you just want to be able to stretch the middle bit and keep your in and out animations consistent. Now you can actually get around this using expressions, but a much simpler method is just to use the keyframe stretcher. So here I've got a very similar in and out animation. And if I jump into Fusion, you can see that we have a whole bunch of keyframes that animate our scene in. Everything then holds for a few frames, and then it animates back out again, all using keyframes. Now in the Effects tab, I'm going to search for a tool called Keyframe Stretcher. And this node has got a very simple function. This is going to hold the keyframes for any node that we feed into it. And right now I'm going to feed my entire node tree into it. Now up here, you'll have a global in and out point for the tool. And this will usually be automatically set to 120 frames. So we want to change this to be the same as our composition length. So this one I'm working on here goes from 0 all the way to 151 frames at the end. But just below it, you'll find these two handles here, which set the in point and out point for the keyframe stretcher. So what we want to do is we want to come over to our timeline here and find the point where our in animation ends, which is right about frame 48. So I'll then set the stretch start to 48. And then we want to find the point right before the animation animates out again, which is at frame 98. So then I'll put 98 into the stretch end. And once you've done that, you've basically done everything you need to do. If I go back into the edit page, I can freely stretch the clip out and it will shift my end animation along to the end of the clip. Basically, the keyframe stretcher tool is taking that middle part of the animation that we selected and extending that out to be the size of our composition. And everything outside of that just gets shifted along to the end of the clip, which is pretty clever. And if you've just watched all of that and you're thinking, man, that is way too complicated for me, I just want a way to save my Fusion compositions, then you probably want to use .conf files instead. Conf files are quite simply a way for you to export exactly what you've made in Fusion node for node. If you go to File, Export, Fusion Composition, you can save your entire node tree as a conf file, which means you can then re-import it into another project in Fusion by going to File, Import, and Fusion Composition. And that, in a nutshell, is how Fusion conf files work. You export them from one project and then re-import them into another one whenever you need them. If you're looking for some cool animations and effects that you could slot into your own videos, then head over to my Buy Me A Coffee page. I'm using this as a place to house some of the stuff that I've made on the channel so far, and I've got some stuff from this video that I've put in there as well. Or if you want some more Fusion tutorials, hit the subscribe button and I'll see you in the next one.